Good afternoon. The first item of business today is portfolio questions, and our first question is number one from Tom Arthur.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I refer members to my register of interest as a member of the Musicians' Union, a former piano teacher and a former director of a function band, to ask the Scottish Government what contribution music education can make towards closing the attainment gap.
Cabinet Secretary John Swinney.
Presiding Officer, Curriculum for Excellence recognises the value of music education, providing children and young people with opportunities to be creative and imaginative, to experience inspiration and enjoyment, and to develop skills for learning, life and work. Through research, we know there are many wider benefits of music education and musical experiences. These include promoting healthy lives and cognitive benefits such as increasing attainment, improving levels of literacy and numeracy, and the emotional, social and physical well-being of our young people.
Tom Arthur.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Given that there is a growing body of evidence suggesting education in music through enhancing development of a student's sound processing abilities can aid in language development, does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that music education for children from the lowest socioeconomic backgrounds could play a crucial and cost-effective role in reducing the word gap?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think there's very clear evidence to support the proposition that Mr. Arthur puts forward. I've seen a number of different ventures in schools around the country where there are challenges in engagement with young people, where the medium of music, for example, has been very successful in engaging young people subsequently in a deeper involvement in literacy and numeracy activity. So I do think this is an important strand of thinking in our education policy, and that's why it forms an increasing part of the Scottish Attainment Challenge.
Ross Thompson.
To ask the Scottish Government what action it is going to take to address the fall in dedicated primary school music teachers from 2008 to the most recent school's census.
Cabinet Secretary.
I think it's really important that we focus on the engagement and the involvement of young people in musical education. That will not just be determined by the number of music teachers, dedicated music teachers we have in primary schools. It will be driven by the degree to which the Curriculum for Excellence is delivered in a comprehensive and fulfilling way in all educational settings within Scotland. And that's the requirement of the of Curriculum for Excellence, that there is a broad range of educational elements of Curriculum for Excellence are delivered for young people. That's the government's expectation, and that's what we look to schools and to local authorities to deliver.
Pauline McNeill.
Presiding Officer, I thank Tom Arthur for laying this important question. But like him, I note that the Journal of Neuroscience recently researched direct evidence showing that music training has a biological effect on children's developing nervous systems. Further to that, shows a large improvement in how the brain processes speech and reading scores better than their peers who haven't been training in music. But given that a number of local authorities are now charging fees, I've long been of the view that that is putting many children off taking up a musical instrument. And I wondered if the Cabinet Secretary would consider some kind of dialogue on that with local authorities and interested parties. I would be really upset if a generation of children, because of austerity or budget cuts, were not getting access to music at a very important time in their lives.
Cabinet Secretary.
I think it's important, well, first of all, I acknowledge Pauline McNeill's long-term interest in these questions, and I accept fundamentally the point that she makes in terms of the educational value and the educational benefit of music tuition. I do, however, want to make it clear to Parliament that it is the duty of every education authority to provide adequate and efficient provision of school education without the payment of fees, and that in relation to my question to Ross Thompson, includes music education into the bargain. So I think this covers music lessons, including when any instrument is taught on a whole class basis, regardless of who is teaching the class. So I think there is adequate provision within the education system to enable that to be the case. But obviously, if there is more detail that members are concerned about in this respect, I'm very happy to engage in that, because I do see the long-term benefits of engagement in music education has been of benefit to the attainment of young people in Scotland.
Stuart McMillan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me, however, that the music education isn't solely the domain of in-house tuition, but also external organisations such as the Boys' Brigade, the Scouts, and also local organised bands can also play their part in considering how the many organisations can assist should not be ruled out, bearing in mind some of the points that have been highlighted on today, such as the challenges and also engagement.
Cabinet Secretary.
I think Mr McMillan makes a very fair point. There are a whole range of different voluntary organisations in Scotland who provide an enormous amount of opportunity for young people in every locality of the country to participate in music. I think one of the great joys that many of us have is when we're looking at some of the musical competitions around our constituencies and communities, they are invariably organisations that are led by voluntary sector representatives. So there is a broad cross-section of activity, and of course we've got to make sure that in every respect that is encouraged and nurtured, and that the regulatory regime that surrounds that is effective in providing the correct amount of safeguarding support for young people, which enables more and more participants to take forward their participation in musical education in Scotland, whether that's formally in the education system or informally within our community.
And Mr Lyle will be pleased to see that we haven't overlooked question number two. Question number two, Richard Lyle.
I thought you had. My apologies. To ask the Scottish Government when it plans to publish updated guidance on tackling bullying.
Cabinet Secretary John Swinney.
Presiding Officer, we've been working for some time on a refreshed national anti-bullying strategy for children and young people, along with a wide range of stakeholders. Our intention is that this will take a holistic approach to addressing this issue. I recently agreed to a request from the Scottish Parliament's Equalities and Human Rights Committee for further engagement by the committee on this issue. I will carefully consider the issues raised by the committee, and I will look to publish the guidance in the spring of 2017.
Richard Lyle.
Answer and welcome the news of the forthcoming guidance on bullying. Indeed, we all must do what we can to tackle this important issue. Can I therefore ask the Cabinet Secretary what work has been undertaken beyond this guidance to tackle bullying in schools?
Cabinet Secretary.
As I said in my original answer to Mr Lyle, there is work underway to refresh that guidance, and I'm very keen to hear the views and the perspectives of the committee on how that can be strengthened. In addition to that activity, the government's already funding Respect Me, which is Scotland's anti-bullying service, which provides support to all adults working with children and young people to give them the practical skills and confidence to deal with all types of bullying behaviour. We are committed to updating our Internet Safety Action Plan by March of 2017 to provide adequate protection in relation to online bullying. We fund Childline to provide confidential advice and information to children. And we provided funding to LGBT Youth Scotland to work collaboratively with Respect Me to produce a resource and deliver practice seminars to teachers and other professionals to address the issue of homophobic, biphobic and transphobic bullying. The government continues to engage with a range of other organisations, including Stonewall Scotland and the Tie Campaign, on all of these different issues. So I give Mr Lyle the assurance that there is a comprehensive approach being taken to tackle bullying, which includes refreshing the strategy that is in place, which we hope to be strengthened by wider dialogue and engagement.
Question number three, Ross Thompson.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. First of all, I'd like to declare an interest as a current and serving councillor on Aberdeen City Council to ask the Scottish Government whether it will clarify what the Education and Skills Secretary meant by radical reform of Scotland's education system following the publication of the recent PISA results.
Cabinet Secretary.
In my statement to Parliament on the 6th of December, I reaffirmed the Government's determination to pursue radical change to improve education in Scotland. That change includes a wide range of reforms which we have already introduced, such as the first ever National Improvement Plan for Education and our targeted approach to closing the attainment gap through the Scottish Attainment Challenge. It also includes reforms to governance arrangements on which we have recently consulted. We will bring forward proposals which will empower teachers, parents and schools to drive forward further improvements in education in due course.
Ross Thompson.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary, for that answer. The Commission on School Reform, in their submission, advocate empowering schools over staffing appointments and budgets, because all the evidence shows that decisions are best taken closest to where they have an effect, and that the greater the autonomy of schools, the better the results. The Government's own governance consultation suggests devolution of power is a good thing, but is not clear on what this will actually involve. Can the Cabinet Secretary clarify what the government really means by greater autonomy and empowering teachers, and if the government is prepared to take on all the vested interests to achieve it?
Cabinet Secretary.
First thing I want to say to Mr. Thompson is that the government has just recently closed the governance review, and it's attracted just short of 1,100 submissions, which the government is currently considering. Parliament will of course accept and understand that I will take the necessary time to consider those views, and I have to do justice to those 1,100 submissions because they cover a range of different perspectives, as I am becoming accustomed to in Scottish education customary in any review of such type. So I will take time to do that, but Mr. Thompson, I don't think my sense is that Mr. Thompson is being mildly critical of the government for not setting out in detail exactly what it plans to do. What the government is undertaking is the government is considering the views of a range of different stakeholders and will come to a considered conclusion in setting out the response to the governance review. That's the correct way to make policy, and that's how the government will proceed on this matter.
Ian Gray.
Will the Cabinet Secretary not agree that the Education Committee report published earlier this week provides strong evidence that if radical reform is needed, it is reform of the SQA and Education Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
As Mr. Gray will understand, the government's consultation on governance included a variety of questions raised about the role of a range of organisations, including the two organisations that he has mentioned of Education Scotland and the Scottish Qualifications Authority. And I give Parliament the assurance that all of these issues will be part of my consideration of these points. But I make the fundamental point to Parliament that if there is as much concern across Parliament about the performance of Scottish education, and I heard that being expressed in the debate last Thursday, then it's right that I should pose hard questions about everybody involved in Scottish education. Now, if local authorities are responsible for the delivery of education in Scotland, which is their statutory responsibility, then I think I'm right, if Parliament is as concerned about education as it says it is, that I should be asking hard questions about local government as well, because that's where the performance of Scottish education is at its most acute. So I will ask the questions that need to be... I've asked the questions in an open fashion in the governance review. I will take the time to consider the issues that have been raised, but I want to make it clear to Parliament that I will be asking hard questions of all organisations involved in Scottish education to make sure we have an education system that can deliver on the expectations of every young person in Scotland and their parents and their carers and their supporters within our country.
Tavish Scott.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I commend the hard question approach to this issue? One of the hard questions the Cabinet Secretary might wish to consider is of the Curriculum for Excellence Management Board, from whom we heard this morning on the Education Committee, and their inability to answer the question who was responsible for the implementation of Curriculum for Excellence. When he's going through his review of these matters, will he undertake to make sure that parents and teachers in particular know who is responsible and for what in the future of the education system across our country?
Cabinet Secretary.
I will look very carefully at the official report of this morning's proceedings. I wasn't able to follow all of the proceedings myself, but I will look carefully at that. But the point which this Mr. Scott asking this question gives me an opportunity to rehearse the answer that I gave in closing the debate on Thursday, which I understand, which for obvious reasons, Mr. Scott wasn't able to be here, but it's all on the official report if he wants to have a look at it. But my point to Parliament last Thursday was that the Curriculum for Excellence Management Board involves, I think if my memory serves me right, about 20 organisations who are brought together to try to create consensus and agreement around the implementation of Curriculum for Excellence. Now, that is the model that has been customary to be taken forward in Scottish education, of bringing together everybody to try to achieve consensus. So that essentially, if that's my answer to Mr. Scott's question about who's ultimately responsible. This has been, and nothing in the implementation of Curriculum for Excellence has been forced upon anybody else. Everybody's agreed with it as we've gone along, with the exception that on one occasion the EIS asked for a delay to the implementation of the examinations by 1 year. That's the only occasion in which a minister took a decision contrary to a unanimous view of the Curriculum for Excellence Management Board. So my answer to Mr. Scott, and I'm sorry for it being a long answer, Presiding Officer, but it's complicated territory. My answer is that we have drawn together in the Curriculum for Excellence Management Board all of the relevant stakeholders to seek consensus around the implementation of curriculum, for excellence, and ministers have respected those views. That's my explanation as to how curriculum, for excellence, has been implemented. Now, I told the Education Committee in December that as part of the government's review, I'm looking afresh at those decisions, because there's a few things that I've done in the course of the last few months in which I've been the Education Secretary to push things at a faster pace and to take decisions that maybe might have taken longer. And I've done that because I felt it was necessary. And perhaps we need a sharper approach to decision making than we've had in the past. And that's one of the issues that I'm currently addressing.
Apologies to James Dornan, but moving to question four, Angus MacDonald.
To ask the Scottish Government what recent discussions it's had with Falkirk Council regarding the Attainment Scotland Fund.
Cabinet Secretary.
We are in regular contact with Falkirk Council, who have received £413,663 from the Attainment Scotland Fund.
Angus MacDonald.
Thank the Deputy First Minister for his reply. He'll be aware of concerns raised by Falkirk Council's education services in their submission to the Scottish Government's consultation on the governance review regarding the potential for additional bureaucracy for schools following the recently announced additional attainment fund monies. Will the Cabinet Secretary take on board these concerns and ensure that schools are not required to implement cumbersome additional monitoring and reporting mechanisms and ensure that existing accountability arrangements and systems are utilised?
Cabinet Secretary.
Officer, we have to take account of the fact that funding is going to be going directly to schools to enable them to have a sharper decision-making about how the monies can be used effectively. And I've seen in Falkirk myself the product of decisions taken at school level about how that improves the way in which educational performance is delivered in individual schools. And now that is public money, it has to be properly accounted for. But I give Mr. MacDonald the assurance that I don't want to have accountability mechanisms that are any more onerous than are required. But I do have to have accountability mechanisms in place that will satisfy the scrutiny of Parliament and the Auditor General in relation to the utilisation of public money.
Alison Harris.
Right. Could I ask the Cabinet Secretary what evidence he could actually provide, which would just reassure, although I think you did allude to it earlier, my constituents in Falkirk, that these proposed new regional education boards would protect and enhance local accountability in terms?
Cabinet Secretary.
The issue about educational collaboration across local authority areas and what has been discussed in the governance review about regional education boards is about ensuring that the best expertise is available to enhance the educational provision of individual schools and for individual young people within areas. Now, there is enough published information from Education Scotland and from the Accounts Commission, which highlights the fact that not all of our local authorities are able to add value to the educational provision of individual schools. And that's evidence I don't think I can ignore as Education Secretary, which is why I'm encouraging collaboration and cooperation between authorities through these regional education bodies. Now, I stressed to Parliament, as I stressed to Liz Smith when I answered her question on the launch of the governance review, this is not an extra layer of bureaucracy, it's a collaborative area to improve performance so that every school in the country can have as much chance to have education improved as a consequence of the interaction of education bodies. And in the north of Scotland, the Northern Alliance, there's a very good example of how local authorities have come together to provide services jointly across that area to tackle particular issues in relation to numeracy and literacy, and also in relation to staff shortages. So there is an argument for that, and that's part of what I'm considering in the governance review.
Question number five, Jeremy Balfour.
To ask the Scottish Government how physical education is helping to narrow the attainment gap.
Cabinet Secretary.
President Officer, physical education can have a positive impact on children's health, educational attainment and life chances. It encourages the development of both movement and thinking skills, and in doing so, contributes to and reinforces learning across the curriculum. I am delighted that 98% of primary and secondary schools across Scotland are providing at least 2 hours or two periods of PE per week. Health and wellbeing's substantial importance is reflected in its position at the centre of the curriculum and at the heart of children's learning, as well as a central focus of the Scottish Attainment Challenge and the National Improvement Framework for Education. Along with literacy and numeracy, it is one of the three core areas that are the responsibility of all staff in schools.
Jeremy Balfour.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his answer? We all agree that sport can help narrow the attainment gap. Yet a report by Reform Scotland recently discovered that some local authorities, including some within the Lothian region, are charging for sports activities that form part of the Active Schools initiative. Would the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that given that the activities are coordinated through a Scottish-wide organisation, it seems strange that there's a difference in charge and practice and that pupils from poorer backgrounds are more likely to miss out as a result of this postcode lottery?
Cabinet Secretary.
On the specific point about the charging arrangements, if Mr Balfour forgive me, I'll take the opportunity to delve into the detail of that and to consider whether there's an issue that needs to be addressed. But in general, I would say that the government is taking a number of steps to encourage greater levels of physical activity. I mentioned in my original answer the performance that is taking place in 98% of primary and secondary schools where at least 2 hours or two periods of PE are being provided each week. And we have other additions to that, such as the Daily Mile, which has engaged Scottish schools very significantly in this process. So I think I also would point out for completeness that later this month I will meet Kenny Logan to hear more about the STEP programme, which he's taken forward, from which there is a great deal of active interest. So I reassure Mr Balfour the government is strongly encouraging the importance of exercise and health and wellbeing at the heart of the curriculum and the education of young people, and I'll look specifically at the issue that he's raised with me.
Question number six, John Mason.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what recent discussions it has had with Glasgow College's regional board and the City of Glasgow College regarding their relationship with each other.
Minister Shirley Ann Somerville.
The Scottish Government regularly meets with the Chair of Glasgow College's Regional Board, and the Government also receives regular updates from the Funding Council on Glasgow Colleges.
John Mason.
I thank the Minister for that answer. I wonder if she agrees that the resources for Glasgow Colleges must be fairly shared between all three of them, and the two more community-based colleges, which is Clyde and Kelvin, should not be disadvantaged just because City of Glasgow shouts louder and has a louder voice.
Minister.
Well, the allocation of resources to Glasgow Colleges is, of course, a matter for the Glasgow Colleges Regional Board and the Funding Council, who have well-established systems in place for allocating those resources. All three colleges, the Regional Board and the Funding Council, are going through a due process at the moment, and that's the correct and proper way of progressing. But I can reassure the member that the sole purpose of that is to ensure delivery of high-quality further education throughout Glasgow.
Liz Smith.
Thank you. Minister, on the 16th of November, I received an answer to a parliamentary question which confirmed that the Scottish Government does not hold the information to confirm the remuneration level which is made to the Chair of Glasgow College's Regional Board. And on the 1st of December, I received a letter from John Kemp confirmed that the Scottish Funding Council does not have that information either. Could the Cabinet Secretary explain why neither the Scottish Government nor the Scottish Funding Council has that information?
Minister.
Well, it is very important that we have transparency and a full understanding about the system that we are setting up with the regional boards. And if Liz Smith isn't satisfied with the answer that she's had back from John Kemp, I'm more than happy to look into that correspondence from the Funding Council and get back to her directly.
Question number seven, Rachel Hamilton.
To ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to close the skills gap.
Minister Jamie Hepburn.
Scotland's labour market strategy recognises that a skilled workforce will be a key component of a more successful and inclusive economy in the years ahead. Our Enterprise and Skills Review, which is currently proceeding in partnership with stakeholders and the relevant agencies, aims to bring greater coherence and focus to the delivery of our skills support. This will focus on fully aligning and coordinating activity across the agencies to maximise their collective impact in meeting the skills, the needs of the labour market. Skills Development Scotland has taken a strong leadership role to understand the skills needs of the labour market through improved regional skills assessments and skills investment plans. This information base will be vital in aligning future skills provision with business need.
Rachel Hamilton.
I thank the Minister for that answer. A survey by the CBI highlighted that 69% of Scottish businesses are not confident about filling high-skilled jobs in the future. This is supported by the IPPR in their report Equipping Scotland for the Future, which highlighted funding as a challenge facing the skills system in the future. Will the Scottish Government demonstrate their commitment to skills funding by increasing the longevity for funding for developing young workforce to allow greater sustainability and increase the number of apprenticeships to 35,000 to tackle the skills gap so evident in the south of Scotland and across Scotland?
Minister.
Well, picking up on the last point, of course, Ms Hamilton will be aware that the UK government of her political party introduced the apprenticeship levy without prior consultation with this government, despite us having responsibility for skills policy. In response to that, of course, we undertook a consultation, and one of the questions we asked was whether or not our target of 30,000 modern apprenticeship starts by the year 2020 was the correct one. The clear message back from business, including the CBI, was that was correct and not to go further. So we have moved forward on that basis, and it's a target we will work towards. In relation to the IPPR report and the concerns of CBI, I am always willing to engage with IPPR and CBI. Indeed, I just met with CBI yesterday. I'm always be willing to discuss these matters with them. But I can tell Ms. Hamilton that the CBI very much welcomed our planned introduction of a flexible workforce development fund as set out in our budget. So I'm hoping she'll be voting for the Scottish Government's budget when it moves ahead.
Colin Beattie.
Could the Minister advise on any progress being made in increasing the studying of STEM-related subjects beyond school?
Well, this is, of course, a very important area for us as an administration. We know that increasingly in the future it will be this type of area that will be important for our future economic growth. There is significant emphasis placed on increasing the number of apprenticeship opportunities in the STEM sector. And, of course, my colleague Shirley-Ann Somerville set out and laid out to Parliament the STEM strategy, which we're currently consulting on, and we'll continue to do all we can to grow the STEM sector.
Daniel Johnson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Rachel Hamilton is right to raise funding of the skills system. Indeed, one of the most important factors in closing the skills gap is supporting young people from low-income families to stay on at school or college. So can I ask, why is the Scottish Government cutting the budget by £10 million? That's 25% from the EMA as laid out in the draft budget. And what will the impact be of that measure?
Minister. Well, I would urge Mr Johnson to look a bit more closely at the budget. What we have, of course, said in the budget, this is a demand-led element of the budget and will meet every single requirement as a consequence of claims made against EMA. If there's a claim for EMA, we'll meet it.
Question number 8, Mark Ruskell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government when it will announce a decision regarding tuition fee support for EU students applying for courses for 2018-19.
Minister Shirley-Ann Somerville.
Despite the UK Government failing as yet to provide adequate reassurance for EU nationals on their immigration status after the point at which the UK leaves the EU, we have provided a clear commitment regarding the continuation of free tuition for eligible EU students applying to commence study in Scotland in 2017-18. In order to plan for 2018-19 and beyond, we continue to urge the UK Government to provide assurances that the immigration status and the rights of EU nationals currently living and studying in Scotland or who wish or to study or work here in the future will not change. A lack of clarity on the UK Government policy in this area is hampering planning, and against this backdrop, it is difficult to point on an exact date which we will be in a position to decide the future policy on this issue. But I can confirm that officials will discuss this matter with representatives of Scotland's universities in the near future.
Mark Ruskell.
Well, can I thank the Minister for that very clear statement? You know, we obviously share the desire to see more talented EU citizens come to this country to contribute to our academia and our society, and it jars with the policy of Westminster. On the issue of the timescale, though, Minister, I mean, it's clear now that universities are drawing up prospectuses for next year. They do need that clarity by April. So is there anything that we can do to try and force the Westminster government to give clarity over the immigration status at that point, then that would be obviously very beneficial to those EU citizens who are considering coming to Scotland but don't yet have clarity over free tuition or indeed their immigration status.
Minister.
Well, I think it would be fair to say it would be good if we could force some clarity from the UK Government on this and on many other issues. And I have a copy of Theresa May's speech from yesterday here, in which it gives no clarity to the EU nationals or indeed to the higher education sector in general, which is a concern. But the member can be reassured that both my officials and myself are in almost constant dialogue with the universities around this, and indeed the other sectors, the other interests within the sector, which they are concerned about with regarding Brexit, whether it's research, EU students, or indeed EU researchers and academic staff, which is also important.
Question number 9, Mike Rumbles.
To
to ask the Scottish Government when it will next meet representatives from Aberdeenshire Council's Education and Children's Services.
Minister Mark McDonald.
Scottish Government officials met with Aberdeenshire Council Education and Children's Services yesterday as part of a meeting of the Association of Directors of Education in Scotland.
Mike Rumbles.
Well, last month, Aberdeenshire Council had 42 teaching vacancies, while Aberdeen City reported 96, that's 96 full-time equivalent posts vacant. Does the Minister understand that his government needs to provide the resources to attract adequate numbers of teachers to the North East and change the situation where both councils constantly receive amongst the worst level of resource funding from the Scottish Government?
Minister.
Well, as Mr. Rumbles will know, this government has put funding in place to protect the pupil-teacher ratios. As well as that, we are working with those councils who are part of the Northern Alliance to look at, for example, expanding opportunities for teacher education places. Also, we're looking at new routes into teaching, including, for example, offering opportunities to individuals working in the oil and gas sector who have been recently made redundant but who wish to perhaps look at teaching as a future opportunity to offer routes in there. So we are exploring a variety of different routes for individuals to get into teaching within the northeast of Scotland. However, if Mr. Rumbles has any constructive suggestions to bring to the table, government will obviously be more than happy to hear from him.
Alexander Burnett.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what has happened to full-time equivalent teacher numbers in schools in Aberdeenshire councils from 2007 to the present, and how this has affected pupil-to-teacher ratios.
Minister.
Well, as Mr. Burnett will know, and as I've just highlighted to Mr. Rumbles, we recognise the pressures that exist in the northeast of Scotland in relation to teaching, recruitment and retention. That is why we have been working closely with those councils, Aberdeen and Aberdeenshire, to ensure that there are additional places for teacher training, to ensure that there are new opportunities for individuals to get into teaching. And again, as I would say, if individuals such as Mr. Burnett have got constructive suggestions to bring to the table about how we could address these matters further, Government would be more than happy to listen to them.
Question number 10, Donald Cameron.
To ask the Scottish Government what it is doing to reduce teacher workload.
Cabinet Secretary Johnson.
Our education delivery plan made clear the Scottish Government's commitment to tackle bureaucracy and address excessive teacher workload. We issued a definitive statement on curriculum for excellence to all teachers, setting out clearly what they are and are not required to do. Her Majesty's inspectors also carried out a focused review of the demands placed on schools by each local authority in relation to curriculum for excellence. We announced concrete proposals to address workload issues, including the decision to remove mandatory unit assessments for National 5 higher and advanced higher qualifications. The removal of mandatory units will significantly reduce workload and liberate teachers to focus on teaching their pupils. My priority in all of this is to free up teachers to concentrate on learning and teaching.
Donald Cameron.
Enable Scotland research found that 62% of subject teachers have experienced anxiety due to the lack of support to help those with additional support needs. Moreover, there has been a drop in the number of special schools teachers of 9% since this government took power in 2007. What action will be taken to stop teachers being overworked? And does the Scottish Government agree that teachers, whether mainstream or in special schools, deserve better?
A number of issues in Mr. Cameron's question. The first is about the general issue of reducing teacher workload to enable teachers to concentrate on learning and teaching, which is my absolute priority and which I've demonstrated very swift action to ensure that is the case. The second point is in relation to what is the changing mix of educational provision within Scotland, because Mr. Cameron will know that there is a presumption in favour of mainstream education for all young people, with the exception that, of course, that where that is not appropriate for young people, they should be educated in appropriate surroundings. That, therefore, it changes, that has led to a significant change in the profile of education, the reduction in the number of special schools, and the much greater integration of young people into our mainstream education. But I do accept the point that teachers must be adequately trained and supported to provide for the educational needs of all young people within their educational setting. So I am very much engaged with the Enable Scotland research on this question, which I think is thoughtful research. When I discussed the issue with enable Scotland before the turn of the year. They made it clear to me their argument was not about more money in the system, their argument was about more effective training and support to enable the fulfilment of young people's educational needs, and the government is committed to making sure that's the case.
Jenny Gilruth.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. There is a stark contrast between this SNP government, which has actually invested to maintain teacher numbers and reduce workload, compared to the actions of Donald Cameron's North Tory colleagues in the UK government, who say that mainstream schools in England should cut their workforce by £1.7 billion over the next 3 years. What are the Cabinet Secretary's views on this?
Cabinet Secretary.
President, sir, the panel will be familiar with the measures the government has put in place to enhance the resources available to the delivery of education in schools within Scotland. The Finance Secretary announced an extra £120 million to support the Scottish Attainment Challenge, higher than what the government committed to in its manifesto, to make sure we can put the resources where they need to be to support the attainment and the performance of young people. The government in Scotland believes in investing in education, and that's what our proposals are aimed to do.
Question number 11, Bruce Crawford.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how much funding it provided toward the building of a new St Margaret's Primary School in Cowie.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, through Scotland Schools for the Future programme, the Scottish Government has provided Stirling Council with £2.6 million towards the construction of St Margaret's Primary School in Cowie.
Bruce Crawford.
The Cabinet Secretary for his answer. I can tell him that I was fortunate enough to attend the opening of the fantastic new primary and nursery school in Cowie on Friday. But can I ask the Cabinet Secretary if he's aware that the official opening of yet another new school, St Ninian's Primary, in Stirling on the 27th of January? Therefore, can you tell me how much funding the Scottish Government is contributing to the building of St Ninian's Primary, and what other funding for school buildings in the Stirling Council area the Scottish Government has provided since 2011.
I'm delighted that the Government's construction programme is providing such opportunities to keep Mr Crawford busy on his constituency Fridays, and it's delightful that they are such happy occasions. I can confirm that the St Ninian's Primary School received £5 million from the Scottish Government in the award to Stirling Council. And through the same programme, the Scottish Government has awarded Stirling Council with funding of £1.9 million towards the refurbishment of Riverside Primary School. And this is all part of the wider programme of investment the Government has taken forward to support the development of first-class educational facilities in Scotland.
Question number 12, Ian Gray.
To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to concerns expressed by the Royal Society of Edinburgh regarding an absence of a clear rationale for the school governance review.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, our education system has many strengths, with thousands of excellent teachers and hard-working children and young people actively involved in taking forward that education system. But the system also faces challenges. The disappointing programme for international student assessment results published in December reinforced the need for reform. The PISA results are consistent with the 2014 Scottish Survey of Literacy and Numeracy, which told us that we needed to do more to make our education system among the best in the world. That is why I'm committed to empowering teachers, parents and schools to drive improvements in education, and why I've launched the Education Governance Review. We owe it to every child and young person in Scotland to ensure that our system supports them to achieve the best possible outcome.
Ian Gray.
Yes, he did not say that they did not believe reform was required in the education system. Rather, they said that the Schools Governance Review missed the mark. And it isn't just the RSE, is it? The EIS, the SSTA, the Scottish Parent Teacher Council, the Scottish Parents Forum, COSLA, SOLAS, even the SNP-led Dundee Council have all, in one way or another, made submissions to the review, querying the whole thrust of the review itself. When parents, teachers, head teachers, academics, and even your own councillors tell you you're barking up the wrong tree, is it not time to think again?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think Mr. Gray confuses two things. He confused it in his response to my initial answer, where he said that the RSE didn't question the motivation for or the need for reform. Because what the government did is the government accepts the need for reform. We've said that very clearly. We set it in our election manifesto for the election in May. But what we undertook in the governance review was an open consultation where the government just didn't say, here is our prescribed model, what do you think of it? We posed a number of searching questions about the performance of every aspect of education. And I come back to the points that I made in answer to one of the Conservative members earlier on. If performance is not as we would like it to be, how on earth can the government conduct a consultation exercise without asking hard questions of everybody involved in education? Everybody, including the government. Of course, the government's agencies are involved there, and the government itself is part of that process. But the issues that have to be confronted are about performance within Scottish education. And is it a surprise that COSLA comes back and tells me, just leave things the way they are? They are responsible. Local authorities are all responsible for the delivery of education in Scotland. And if that performance is not good enough, which Mr. Gray tells me on a regular basis is the case, I should be asking hard questions of local authorities and other bodies. And we shouldn't be surprised if local authority bodies come back and say, don't disturb anything because everything is fine, because they are the ones responsible for the current system. Now, Mr. Gray is saying to me that's not what they're saying. Well, I've read the COSLA submission and that's what it says to me. Now, on the question about the RSE and it's the point about a clear rationale, the test of whether there's a clear rationale will come from the proposals the government brings forward. That's the test we've got to pass. We've got to listen to the evidence, which I'm going to take care to do, and I'm not going to be in a hurry to address it. I'm going to listen carefully and consider carefully the issues. And then I will bring forward a clear rationale for reform of Scottish education based on the fact that we must improve performance to give every young person the best chance they can for their future in Scotland. And nobody in Parliament should be in any way shy of confronting that issue.
Thank you. That concludes portfolio questions. We now move on to a statement from the Cabinet Secretary, Shona Robson. We'll just take a few seconds to change seats.